Good morning and welcome to Shiloh Reformed Church worship service here this morning. I'm Pastor Richard Myers. We are so glad that you could join us here and online. We are thankful to have you during this next hour together. And as always, we want to start with a few announcements before we go right into worship. Again, remind everyone we have our called congregational meeting immediately following the service today regarding the request of Faith Academy Charter School to use some of our church grounds. We will have all the details even more there, but that will be immediately following our worship service here today. So we hope to have those still coming in, or if you are not here and would like to make sure you're in the parking lot, if you're worried about coming in, that you could still come and vote in that regard out in your car. It is the deadline to clean out your church mailboxes. Any mail that's not picked up by today will be discarded. We've been talking about this for a month, so if you have someone you know in your family that needs their mailbox cleaned out and want to make sure they keep their mailbox, today would be the day to do that. Because any mailboxes that have not been emptied for the last year, they will not be put back out to start for 2021. They will be updated starting on February 1st, which is tomorrow. We have our personnel committee and music committee chair meeting this Tuesday at 6 in the pastor's office. And again, if you'll just look at some of the other needs and corrections and announcements in our bulletin at this time. But for now, I invite you to quiet your hearts along with me as we prepare to enter into worship together. Father God, as the rain is falling outside right now, we pray that you will pour out your Holy Spirit upon us during this hour. As we seek to glorify you and to give our lives to you as a living sacrifice, holy and pure and acceptable to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you'll join me now as we state what we believe through the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only begotten Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Are you ready to sing? Yes. Well, good. Let's sing "Oh, Worship the King."
Shield and defender be.
Let us pray. Lord God, it is amazing how often we think that we can take on the world when things are going so well. But when things go wrong in our lives, suddenly we find ourselves, as this great hymnist wrote, frail children of dust and feeble as frail. We come today, Lord, declaring that it is in Thee that we do trust, and that we never find You to fail. We thank You, Lord, and praise You for Your mercies that You pour out upon us day after day after day. When we let You down, Lord, and come back to You humble and repentant, You forgive us. When we do things that leave You out of our lives, You are still often gracious to continue to meet our needs. But Lord God, we come today recognizing that we do not need to take You for granted, and nor will You accept us taking You for granted. For Your sacrifice on the cross through Your Son, Jesus Christ, was an awesome price to pay. And that while His love and forgiveness and eternal life on that cross that He offers are free, they are far from cheap. And Lord God, we know that the least that we can do in return is to give our lives back to You in thanksgiving and in obedience. Lord God, we come today recognizing, as always, that we can't earn our salvation. We can't give enough in the offering plate. We can't attend church enough. We can't do enough good things for other people in this world to ever make up for the chasm that was put between us and You because of our sin. But we give You praise that through Jesus Christ, we can personally and intimately draw near to You, both in the joys of this life, giving thanks and praise to You, and in the trials in this life, pouring out our hearts to You, seeking for You to provide, seeking for Your power, and seeking for Your grace. Lord God, we pray that You'll help us to demonstrate that same love, that same power through Your Holy Spirit in our own lives, so that others can see You not only working on us and in us, but through us in this world. You do not call us to simply accept Your Son and to sit on it, as we would say, but You call for us to get out of our seats and to go into the world as Jesus left His heavenly seat for our sake in heaven. You call us, just as He did, to give up comfort at times in order to reach others who are hurting, who are struggling in poverty, who are trying to pick up the pieces emotionally after the loss of a loved one, who are simply trying to make it in this world. And You call us to reach out to folks who do not yet know Your Son, Jesus Christ, and to be His hands and feet here in this world. As the body of Christ, help us to faithfully accept that charge and that challenge. And through Your strength, not our own, but through Your strength, Your guidance, and Your wisdom, seize each and every opportunity that we have day after day after day, whether it be in our home with our families, whether it be at school with our students or our classmates, whether it be at work with our bosses or our coworkers or those beneath our authority. We pray that You'll help us to be Jesus' light out in the community. We pray for our brothers and sisters around the world, many of which are suffering greater trials than we could ever begin to imagine. And we ask for Your Holy Spirit to empower them in a special way to meet the challenges that are before them. We're reminded that the gates of Hades cannot overcome your church. Satan's doom is sure. And so when we see him at work in this world, we know that he's just trying to do as much damage before you put the ultimate shutdown upon him. And we thank you, Lord, that that day is coming. But until then, help us to be about shutting down Satan's agenda. To stand up when we need to stand up with boldness and love and truth. And again, Lord, we thank you that we don't have to navigate this world on our own. If we're doing well today, remind us how frail we are. If we are feeling our frailty in its fullness as we're going through a difficult time, may you pour out your power in a mighty way and fill our hearts as we seek to serve you. And now, Lord, as we seek to keep our focus upon you, we once again lift up that prayer that Jesus gave us as a model prayer as we continue to lift our hearts up to you, praying as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
The next song in your bulletin is He is Exalted. The choir is going to sing it through twice, and I'd like to invite the congregation then to sing it through the third time. He is exalted. This is a learning moment for the congregation. We're going to learn a new song today.
We all face times in our lives when we come under pressure, and how we respond often sets the trajectory for our lives and leaves behind the legacy with which we will be remembered. In sports, we often hear the term crunch time. It's used to describe when a high-pressure game is on the line. For instance, if a basketball team is down by 1 point in the closing seconds of the big game, a single play can determine the outcome and catapult a player's career. Back in 1982, many of us here remember, with just under 20 seconds left in the college national championship game, the UNC Tar Heels were down by 1 point to the Georgetown Hoyas. It was then that a young true freshman by the name of Mike Jordan took the open jump shot and hit nothing but nylon. Concerning his game-winning jumper, Jordan reflected in an interview not too long ago. He said, quote, "Up until that point, no one knew who I was. Outside of the university, I was just known as Mike Jordan. When I hit that shot, my whole name became Michael Jordan." For those of us that followed his career, we understand what he meant by that. Jordan would go on to have two more successful years as a leader of the UNC Tar Heel basketball team, getting several accolades along the way, including being recognized as the Sporting News National Player of the Year in 1983, and that was recognized as the Consensus National Player of the Year in 1984. He went on to the pros, where his acolytes continued to accumulate. He was the 1985 NBA Rookie of the Year. He won two slam dunk contest championships, five most valuable player awards, six NBA championships, and a whopping 14 appearances in the NBA All-Star game with along with a whole host of other honors throughout the years. When the game was on the line, the ball was in his hands because he was a clutch performer under pressure. He made numerous game-winning, buzzer-beating plays, whether it was passing the ball for the winning score to the right player or whether it was taking the game-winning shot himself. I think his life is kind of a microcosm, if you will, of how decisions under pressure and the way we respond to that pressure often affect not just our own lives for a short while, but the rest of our lives. It also impacts those around us, whether it be our family, our teammates, our classmates, our coworkers, or others. You see, we model to our children and grandchildren how pressure can either make us bitter or better, because they're watching and they're learning, not so much through what we say, but through what we do and how we live. If we allow pressure to get the best of us, it can skew our perception of ourselves and even reality. It can lead to bad decisions. It could sink us into depression and ruin us and our relationships. If we stand tall under pressure, even if we fail or fall a few times along the way, like most of us do, it can lead to us having healthy and loving relationships, experiencing genuine contentment and joy in life. It can help us make wise choices and see ourselves as victors rather than victims. That's why it's important for us to consider how we typically respond to pressure. Do we tend to choke, as they say? Do we tend to start out strong, but are tempted to fold and collapse if the stress continues and shows no sign of letting up anytime soon? Or do we tend to face our challenges as Winston Churchill did? Churchill, if you will recall, was the Prime Minister of the United Kingdom during the Nazi assaults in World War II. There were some dark, dark days. And during his leadership, he had to endure both the intense pressure politically from within the country as well as the outside threat of the Nazis. It was this great leader who said this. Think about this. "A pessimist sees the difficulty in every opportunity. An optimist sees the opportunity in every difficulty." Let me read that one more time. A pessimist sees the difficulty in every opportunity. An optimist sees the opportunity in every difficulty. Pressure presents opportunity. An opportunity can either be seized or squandered. It's our choice. We see, as we turn to 1 Kings 17, as we began looking at it last week, Elijah, at this point in his ministry, seized the opportunity. Verse 1, now Elijah the Tishbite from Tishbe in Gilead said to Ahab, as the Lord, the God of Israel, lives, whom I serve, there will be neither dew nor rain in the next few years except at my word. Now, last Sunday, we began by looking at this one verse, and we discovered two important truths, the first two in our outline. In the outline, it states, when we stand tall under pressure, tall being our acronym, T-A-L-L, we stand tall under pressure when we, first of all, trust that God is living and active. Trust that God is living and active. Elijah proclaims to the idolatrous king Ahab right off the bat that he serves the Lord, the true God of Israel, the living God. When we face challenges, when we encounter seasons in our lives that seem daunting and dark, we must remember that God is not dead, that Jesus has risen from the grave and will return, and that His Holy Spirit is actively still working in us and around us in this world. We must not get so focused on what seems to be wrong in this world that we fail to see what God is doing around us. We must not grow so discouraged by what is wrong that we fail to be encouraged to do what is right. We must look at ourselves and our worlds through the eyes of faith in order to see our God at work so that we can join Him in His efforts to build His kingdom, both in our own hearts and lives and in the world. The second thing we noticed about verse 1 was that of all things Elijah could have brought up, he pronounced a drought upon the land. This was in accordance with Deuteronomy 11, if you'll remember. It was there that God promised to bless the Israelites with rain and crops if they faithfully and obediently served Him. But it was also there that He promised them drought and famine if they served other gods, as Ahab was misleading the nation to do. Knowing this to be true, James 5:17 tells us that Elijah prayed for the drought in agreement with God's promise. Which brings us to the second point. We stand tall under pressure when we act according to God's promises. Act according to God's promises. When we find ourselves in difficult or even hostile environments, we must trust, pray, and act according to God and His word, leaving the consequences up to Him, good or bad, in our estimation. And this brings us up to date to our current scripture for today. In verse 2, then the word of the Lord came to Elijah, leave here, turn eastward, and hide in the Kirith ravine, east of the Jordan. You will drink from the brook, and I have ordered the ravens to feed you there. Confronting this king with bad news of a drought and judgment, as Elijah did, was risky business. Later we will find out that Queen Jezebel began a campaign to kill off all the Lord's prophets during this drought. Knowing the danger that was coming, it seems likely that God said, Elijah, you need to get out of town and hide for his own safety. But then again, maybe there was a whole lot more going on than just simply that. Perhaps God had a reason for Elijah getting away by himself. Perhaps God wanted to reveal himself and his character to Elijah in a new and powerful way. Perhaps God wanted to teach Elijah, mold and shape his character out in the wilderness, and grow his faith and trust in him in order to prepare him for the challenges that lie ahead. Perhaps God sent Elijah to hide in the Kereth Ravine for all of those reasons and more. You see, God is often working in us in this world on levels that we can't even begin to comprehend when we're in the moment, when we're under pressure. And when he asks us to do something, even if it doesn't make sense, such as go out to the Kereth Ravine and the birds will feed you. Does that make a lot of sense? See, often we can't see where it is all heading, but we can trust the one who does. And that brings us to the third point in our outline. We stand tall under pressure when we listen for God's daily guidance. Listen for God's daily guidance. Notice, God didn't do what we often want these days. He didn't give Elijah a 5-year plan of how to achieve your goals. It's not what God does. He simply tells him to go and hide in a Kereth Ravine for now, where there will be a wadi, that is a brook that is dependent upon the seasonal rains whose water supply comes from them. There he will be fed by ravens, birds that were considered to be unclean. You reckon he gagged a little bit over this thought? It may have even sounded crazy to Elijah at first, because none of this would have been expected. None of this would have been on his radar. Think about it. When God first told him that he would be fed by these unclean ravens, I bet he said to himself, "This is for the birds." I got one boo out of that. Anyway, seriously, Elijah listens to God and trusts in his daily direction, despite any reservations or concerns that he may have had. Look back at chapter 17 if you got your Bibles there. So he did what the Lord had told him. He went to the Kereth Ravine east of the Jordan and stayed there. The ravens brought him bread and meat in the morning and bread and meat in the evening, and he drank from the brook. Now here's the thing. He knew that brook was going to dry up any time now. There was a drought. And sooner or later, it would all run out. He didn't have the 5-year plan. But he still trusted God and obeyed him, even though he didn't. Theologian Dr. Henry Blackaby, in his groundbreaking book, Experiencing God, observed this. He said, quote, "Often people approach knowing and doing God's will this way. They ask, 'Lord, what do you want me to do? When do you want me to do it? How shall I do it? Where shall I do it? What will the outcome be?'" That's usually the big one for me. He goes on to say, isn't this response most typical of us? We are always asking God for a detailed roadmap. We say, "Lord, if you could just tell me where I am heading, then I will be able to set my course and go." He says, "You don't need to. What you need to do is follow me one day at a time." We need to come to a place where our response to God will be, "Lord, just tell me what to do one step at a time, and I will do it." How many of us have reached that point in our own walks with God? Years ago, when the girls and I were heading the Emerald Isle for our annual vacation with the Myers family, we encountered a wreck, a road construction or something. I can't remember what it was. So suddenly, there was this unexpected challenge that would send us into unfamiliar territory. You see, it was already getting late and growing dark, and I didn't want to be stuck in traffic all night long. So I put the destination of where we were heading into my Google GPS, and off we went as it rerouted us. Now, those of you that have ever done that, you know that it can put you on some funky adventures, to say the least. None of the roads were familiar to us. Many times it felt like we were heading in the wrong direction. There were times when I wondered if we were even heading to who knows where. At one point in the pitch black darkness of the night, we were riding on a dirt road through the middle of a field with no lights in sight. It's dark, even with my little headlights. And I look at Wendy and I'm like, this is leading us where we want to go. You know, because it kind of felt like a scene out of a horror movie almost there for a little bit. Because we were out in the middle of nowhere. And we couldn't see, have any clue where we were much. And after all, Google GPS, I knew from experience, can mess people up. Several years back, I'm out at the office and somebody pulls in and says, can you tell me where the courthouse is? They put in Main Street Faith. I mean, Main Street Salisbury, and they wound up at Main Street Faith by their GPS. So it's not like Google GPS is 100% accurate all the time. Nevertheless, we continued down that dirt road and followed its directions, one road, one turn at a time, with no clue where we were. But eventually we reached the big intersection that we recognized right outside of Emerald Isle. We were coming down a different road, of which we had previously been fairly unfamiliar. But even so, we still arrived in Emerald Isle, or should I say, the Promised Land at that point. You know, sometimes in life we come under pressure when we encounter unexpected setbacks. And they send us off course from where we expected to be heading. It puts us in unfamiliar territory. In those times, God desires to lead us one road, one turn at a time. But we must trust Him to get us to the right place at the right time and follow His lead, even when it doesn't look or feel right. Even when it feels like we're heading in the wrong direction. Even when it's dark and we find ourselves out in the middle of nowhere. At times like these, we need to remember that if we follow God's daily directions, even when we can't see where we're heading, one day we will reach the ultimate destination of the new heaven and the new earth that will come with Christ's return. You see, the big difference between God's GPS and Google GPS or any other GPS that's man-made is that God's will never steer us wrong, no matter how wrong it may feel in the moment. Well, Elijah was following God's GPS. And in verse 7, we read, sometime later, the brook dried up because there had been no rain in the land. Then the word of the Lord came to him, go at once to Zarephath of Sidon and stay there. I have commanded a widow in that place to supply you with food. You may not recognize it yet, but the twists and turns for Elijah are still going strong. When the brook dries up due to the drought, God directs Elijah to Zarephath of Sidon. That's enemy territory. That's the general area where Queen Jezebel, who was wreaking havoc back in Israel, was from. That's right in the middle of idol country, if you will. False god country. Not only that, Elijah was directed to seek food from a widow. Widows back then were typically poverty-stricken for the most part. And when Elijah arrives at her house, it seems to go from bad to worse. Look at what happens next. So he went to Zarephath. When he came to the town gate, a widow was there gathering sticks. He called to her and asked, would you bring me a little water in a jar so I may have a drink? As she was going to get it, he called, and bring me, please, a piece of bread. Hear how she responds. As surely as the Lord your God lives, she replied, I don't have any bread, only a handful of flour in a jar and a little oil in a jug. I'm gathering a few sticks to take home and make a meal for myself and my son, that we may eat it and die. How would you have felt if you were Elijah? God, you sent me to this woman to ask her for bread? This one? Is this the one you meant? Most of us at this point, if we were in Elijah's shoes, would have probably assumed that we were heading in the wrong place or we had arrived at the wrong house, but not Elijah. This brings us to our fourth point. We stand tall under pressure when we look for God's daily power and provision. Look for God's daily power and provision. God usually gives us what we need when we're really in the center of His will, whether it be on an emotional level, a material level, a physical level, or spiritual level. He will give us exactly what we need for that moment. And in verse 13, Elijah said to her, "Don't be afraid. Go home and do as you have said. But first, make a small cake of bread for me from what you have and bring it to me. And then make something for yourself and your son. For this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. The jar of flour will not be used up, and the jug of oil will not run dry until the day the Lord gives rain on the land." She went away and did as Elijah had told her. So there was food every day for Elijah and for the woman and her family. For the jar of flour was not used up, and the jug of oil did not run dry, in keeping with the word of the Lord spoken by Elijah. The drought that Elijah had forecasted has far-reaching effects. When Elijah meets this poor Gentile widow, she is getting ready to make her one last meal for her son and herself, and then she expects to die. I'm assuming by starvation. The widow and her son's situation looks dire. And on top of all that, there comes this false prophet who shows up and encourages her to make him a small cake of bread with what little bit they have left. This was a tall order for a desperate mother, but Elijah encourages her to not be afraid. How many times have we been tempted to give up as this poor mother was ready to do? How many times have we heard someone investing everything, heard of someone investing everything into a relationship? They put their whole self-worth into this relationship only to lose that special someone somehow, allowing it to sink them into depression and sometimes even to the point of suicide. How many times have we given in to desperation because of financial or even election losses? How many times have we had the familiar resources and relationships on which we regularly depend run out and run dry, causing us to question God? Hear the words spoken by Elijah here and by Jesus Christ numerous times throughout His ministry. Do not be afraid. You see, God is about to reveal Himself to this mother and Elijah as the great provider, as He miraculously supplies their needs through an unexpected means. Many of you may not be familiar with the name Watchman Nee. He was a Christian preacher and church leader in China during the 20th century. In his 30 years of ministry, God used him to oversee the planting of numerous local churches throughout the nation there. He wrote and published several Christian books and held multiple conferences for the training of church workers and Bible students. During his ministry, he suffered with a multi-year bout with tuberculosis, a chronic stomach disorder, and a severe heart condition of which he was never cured. On top of that, there was the Chinese Communist Revolution in the late 40s and 50s. after the communist takeover, Nee was arrested in March of 1952 and incarcerated for his faith, given a 15-year sentence. On May 30th, 1972, Nee died while he was in prison for the sake of the gospel. It was this Watchman Nee, this Christian servant leader, who once observed this. He said, because of our proneness to look at the bucket and forget the fountain, God has frequently to change his means of supply to keep our eyes fixed on the source. All right, that's hard just hearing it. Let me read it one more time. Because of our proneness to look at the bucket and forget the fountain, God has frequently to change his means of supply to keep our eyes fixed on the source. He goes on to say, the streams that refreshed us are allowed to dry up. And the ravens that brought us our daily food visit us no longer. But then God surprises us by meeting our needs through a poor widow. And so we prove the marvelous resources of God. In short, what Nee is saying is there are times in life when the resources with which we have grown familiar and dependent and are often taken for granted, they run out. When our relationships fail us, when there is nothing or no one left who appears to be equipped to meet our financial, material, emotional, physical, or spiritual needs. But nevertheless, at those times we can trust in the Lord to give us new resources, new relationships, and other things we need to meet our daily needs. It is then that we learn to fix our eyes on the fountain flowing with the living water of Jesus Christ, rather than focusing so much on the bucket. When we find ourselves in the wilderness, we can trust that God will provide our daily bread, as he provided manna for the Israelites in their own wilderness. In Matthew chapter 6, Jesus said it this way: do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? Or what shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? For the pagans run after all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given to you as well. Therefore, do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. What are we worried about today that we need to turn over to the Lord, who provides our daily provision and gives us the daily strength we need to tackle life one day at a time? In the case of Elijah and this widow, he miraculously provided food for them and her family. But the tragedy strikes again when you look at verse 17. Sometime later, the son of the woman who owned the house became ill. He grew worse and worse and finally stopped breathing. She said to Elijah, "What do you have against me, man of God? Did you come to remind me of my sin and kill my son?" I wonder how many of us have ever been where this widow was, where it seems like life is just piling on one thing after another. It's like you can't even get fully rested and relieved from the first trial before a next bigger trial even falls on you. Like her, we may have asked, God, do you have something against me? Are you doing this to me because of my sin in my life, Lord? Now, it's important to remember that not all suffering can be personally and directly attributed to sin in our lives. Sometimes God takes our suffering and uses it as an opportunity to display his power. You remember when the disciples came across that blind man and they asked Jesus this in John chapter 9? Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind? You remember Jesus' response? He said, neither this man nor his parents sinned, but this happened so that the work of God might be displayed in his life. When Jesus got word that Lazarus was critically ill, you remember what he said? This sickness will not end in death. No, it is for God's glory, so that God's Son might be glorified through it. Then Jesus arrives when it seems to be too late, after Lazarus had been in the tomb for a few days. The funeral was long over, but he arrived so that we might believe and trust in him, when he says, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me will live even though he dies, and whoever lives and believes in me will never die. When the widow's son died, Elijah saw divine opportunity for God's works and God's power to be displayed in that difficulty, just as Jesus had seen divine opportunity in the case of the blind man and the dead man. Verse 19. Give me your son, Elijah replied. He took him from her arms, carried him to the upper room where he was staying, and laid him on his bed. Then he cried out to the Lord, O Lord my God, have you brought tragedy also upon this widow I am staying with by causing her son to die? Then he stretched himself out on the boy three times and cried to the Lord, O Lord my God, let this boy's life return to him. The Lord heard Elijah's cry, and the boy's life returned to him, and he lived. Elijah picked up the child and carried him down from the room into the house. He gave him to his mother and said, Look, your son is alive. And look at her response at this point. Then the woman said to Elijah, Now I know that you are a man of God, and that the word of the Lord from your mouth is the truth. God revealed his power and provision to this widow and Elijah on multiple occasions, daily. As a result, she acknowledged the truth in the word of the Lord as proclaimed by Elijah. How many people, I got to thinking as I read this, in the world today desperately need to not only hear the word of God, but also see the power of God working as she saw working through Elijah. How does God desire his power to work through us? If we fully surrender to God's daily direction and faithfully accept his provision, we too will see his power at work in us, through us, and around us. And as we personally experience his power in our lives, our confidence and faith in him will grow and get us ready for the challenges that lie ahead. For Elijah, it was his impending showdown with the false prophets of Baal at Mount Carmel. But that's another story for another Sunday. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your provision when we haven't seen it. We thank you for your power when we didn't realize what it was. We thank you for your guidance. And we pray that in all these things, we will accept them as they are. Help us to place our trust more in you than we do the resources with which you often bless us. Help us to never forget the ever-flowing fountain of living water that provides all the blessings that we enjoy, so that when the rivers of this life and this world seem to run dry, we still never thirst, for you fill our every need day by day. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Did you know that there's a song about the Lord's GPS? It's called All the Way My Savior Leads Me. Would you please stand and sing?
Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Amen. Thank you.